Welcome everyone. It's my pleasure to have Nikhil Bansal from the Eindhoven University here. Nikhil was previously at the IBM TJ Watson Research Center, where he was managing the algorithms group. And he's done a lot of impressive work in algorithms and won best paper awards, most notably for the K-server problem. And today he's going to talk us about, tell us about fast subset sum in polynomial time. So,
great. Thanks, Nikhil. Yeah. Thanks for the invite. Yeah. So, good. So, I guess I don't need to use this. So, I'll talk about this fast subset sum algorithm using polynomial space and explain what all these things mean. And this is joint work with Shashwat Garg, who's a PhD student, Jesper Nederlof, who's also at Eindhoven, and an undergrad from IIT Bombay, Nikhil Vyas. He was visiting over the summer last year. Yeah, last year. Good. Or maybe this year, yeah. Okay. Right. So let's begin. So what's the subset sum problem? We all know this. So, and I'll just call it SS for short. So you are given some n numbers, W1 through WN, and you are given some target T. And you want to figure out, is there a subset X of these indices so that if I sum up all these numbers in that subset, it sums exactly to that target, right? Right. So we all know, so one way to solve this as problem is via brute force. So let's look at various solutions. So you can do this in 2 to the n time by trying out all the subsets and see which one sums up to T. So this is just brute force. Now we also study, usually, I guess, in the first course on dynamic programming and algorithms. You can also do it in, okay, and when I write 2 to the n, I'll ignore like poly n factors and all, right? So similarly, okay, and sometimes I'll be a bit more precise. You can do this in order T times n by dynamic programming. Right? Again, just to maybe remind you, you compute for every sort of partial. So T is this target, right? So in general, this could be a big number. Like think of this as roughly being as large as 2 to the n or something. So the point is if
non-negative.
Okay, good. Yeah. So let's assume WIs are non-negative. Yeah, and there is some big target. Right, so again, these, once you think of these as big numbers, like exponentially large or something, right? And yeah, so this dynamic programming is just you like order the numbers W1 to W and so on, and then for every sort of prefix of I numbers and every possible sum S less than or equal to T, you keep a table like which is 0 or 1, depending on whether you can generate S using these, some subset of these first. Yeah?
So the goal is here is to pick as small number of possible items as possible, or just
no,
want to
just
get
any.
Just want to get them very close to T, or
exactly.
Exactly.
Yes. Yeah, and actually, all these variants are kind of related. So for now, let me define subset sum as exactly equal to T, right? Okay. And in a sec, I'll talk a bit about these other variants. Okay. So these are the two very like this is naive. This is standard dynamic programming. There is another way. People can't read here, let me know and I'll go there. But you can also do it in like 2 to the n over 2 time. And this is known since the 60s or early 70s based on what's called the meet in the middle approach. And I'll describe this in a second. So the idea here, it's a very cute idea. And again, it's used a lot in crypto and various other places. Also an algorithm. So the idea is the following. So you take your n numbers that you have, so maybe, right, break it into two halves, let's say left and right of n over two numbers each, right, just arbitrarily. And now for each of these n over two numbers, compute all possible 2 to the n over 2, take all the 2 to the n over 2 subsets and compute their sums, right, store that in a big table, do the same here. Compute all the sums. So far you have only spent like 2 to the n over 2 times some poly n time. And now you do the following. So you have computed these big lists of 2 to the n over 2, sort them, which again is almost linear time. Now for every number A, you go over this list one by one. For every number A, you check whether T minus A exists in this list or not, right? And this you can do by binary search because you have sorted So it takes like negligible time, right? So it's easy to see that everything sort of takes 2 to the n over 2 time, plus roughly polynomial factors for sorting up. Okay, so it's a very cute trick and sort of it gives you a big improvement. Okay, so these are sort of three classic algorithms. Now let's look at the space. So this was the running time. What about the space for these things? So if I was doing the brute force, I could sort of run it in, you know, order n space, because I just, you know, the sum that I'm computing right now, I just need to keep track of that, right? If it's t, I stop, otherwise I go on to the next one. So I don't need to store anything. What's the space in this one? It's sort of order tn, right? Because I'm storing this table, or maybe n square or something, who knows. I'll ignore, I'll not be very, because sort of this, or maybe nt, right? So this can have n values and this can have up to t. Okay, now it turns out there was a very clever way, nice paper actually a few years ago in Stock 10 by Lokshtanov and Nederlof, which showed that you can do this actually much better. So you can do this in basically poly n, let's say n cube log t. So again, t is the bad guy, right? It's usually very big. So they showed a very nice technique using Fourier analysis where you can do it only in this much space. It's kind of surprising. Okay. But again, we won't sort of, we'll see this doesn't help us for what we are after. Now for this third algorithm, the way we presented the space requirement is about 2 to the n over 2, right? Because you're computing all these sums. Right, so this also uses space, 2 to the n over 2. And again, there was a very nice paper, I think in early 80s by Shamir and Schroeppel. I might be messing up the spelling. Which showed that you can get the same running time, 2 to the n over 2, but only with 2 to the n over 4 space. So it's sort of a very clever trick. Like you don't sort of compute this all up front, only sort of do it on demand, right? So in roughly speaking, they take this 2 to the n over 2 and split it further into sort of n over 4 and 4. So it's sort of a very clever, cute trick, but again, something that you can teach like an undergrad course, right? So this basically, this is kind of the state of the art. So one way to summarize this is the following, that if I give you sort of only poly space, right, the best we know is 2 to the n running time, like a brute force. Yeah. And also notice here, if t is like 2 to the n, you know, I don't have any way of, right, so this sort of result doesn't help us, right? So we won't talk about these pseudo polynomial results, because if t is like 2 to the n, they don't give you anything. Okay, so in polyspace, this is the best we know to do. And if you allow me 2 to the n over this much space, or in fact any space, like even much more, the best we know is 2 to the n over 2 time, the Shamir Schroeppel result, right?
In cube log t in space,
right? Yes, yes. So it is a very good space, but still, if your t is like 2 to the n, No, so, but the running time is still 2 to the...
Okay, so you...
So it's not giving you sort of a different point on this curve, right? In general, so think of t as being 2 to the n, right? Yeah, so the space is great, but it's not beating brute force. Okay?
And also this last trick, dividing by 2 to the power of n over 2, why can't you repeat it and what?
That's a good question. Yeah, the first time you see it, that's a natural thought. Somehow, yeah, I mean... If you could do anything like this, yeah, it'll be an amazing result. So indeed, what's sort of two big open problems in this area is, beat, 2 to the n over 2. So if you could give some any 1 minus epsilon running time and, you know, take whatever space you want, right? Infinite space. We don't know. And yeah, it's sort of a very tantalizing question. Yeah, maybe you could do something recursive, who knows. But and on the other hand, so for many problems, like in these exact algorithms, you know, people make this assumption called strong SETH, that for k large enough, k sat cannot be solved in, you know, even anything better than 2 to the n time. But nobody knows how to reduce this to subset sum. Somehow there are these difficulties. And for all we know, I mean, there could be a 2 to the little o of n algorithm for subset sums. There is no better hardness, even assuming strong SETH. So this is kind of an interesting open question. The second open question is, right, so if I allow you only, say, Pauli space, right, this is the other extreme, can you beat this naive 2 to the n? Thing was known. And we'll focus on this problem in our talk. So what we show in this paper is that we can give an algorithm which runs in 2 to the 0.86 n. So it's sort of reasonably better than 2 to the n. And it only uses Pauli space. Okay. And so this will be a randomized algorithm. So in particular, like, it'll succeed, say, with some constant probability of success. But of course, one can repeat it enough times and get a good probability. But one thing is, when you talk of polynomial space algorithms and you're using randomness, right, one also needs to, so in particular, our algorithm will use a lot of random bits during its execution, right? So where is, if I have only polynomial space, like here I have exponential time, so in general, I'll need exponential many random bits. So there is this question of how are you getting your random bits? Right? So also, like, if you remember, there is this classical log space of Reingold, right? So you want to find a path from S to T, right? But somehow you'll use a lot of randomness along the way, poly n bits. But if you have only poly log space, what do you do? So there are various models. So one is, we can assume, actually, yeah, let's do it in sort of the increasing order of power. So one is, you assume you have some online oracle that gives you these random bits. Like, you press a button and you get a random bit, right? And you keep doing this. So you don't have to store anything in your head. You just press a button and it'll give you a random bit. So online on demand, kind of. The second model could be, there is a large read-only tape, right? So there is this big tape, as big as you want, with sort of hard-coded 0101 random bits. So you can just sort of read with random access on this tape, right? So.
Why is it different from the online?
Okay, good. So it's a bit different because you can go back.
Oh, you have random access.
Yes.
Doesn't this give you memory?
Okay, so
because
good.
You can remember a position where you know, what you want to memorize is encoded in the random string.
Okay, good. But how, somebody can still only store a few positions, right? I mean, I only have...
But it does give you a certain amount.
Yes, yes. So this is strictly more powerful. And we'll see so this is indeed more. It's more powerful. Actually, we'll, just to give the suspense, so we'll actually work in this model and we don't know how to get this. But still, you know, your working space.
So is the online oracle model read once where you can just advance the head and not go back?
Yes, yes. So it's also, yeah, same. Read once, exactly. Yeah. Yeah, so complexly we will call it read once, whatever, yeah. Right. And we'll think of, okay. And an even more powerful assumption could be that you just have, you know, strong pseudo-random generators. So because once you have, if you have a, you know, for whatever assumption of strong rule, you can just take a small seed and just generate this on the fly as you need it. And, you know, typically these pseudo-random generators also assume that, you know, if you give an index I in log I or polylog I time, you can access the ith bit. So it sort of models this.
Now what's the difference between the second and the third one?
Okay, so this definitely sort of implies this. And again, sort of, I'm not the complexity expert, especially on space-bounded computation. It could be this sort of implies this under certain conditions and so on. But sort of, this is at least stronger, right? So this is in the order of increasing power. And again, all these three assumptions, when people talk of space-bounded computation, they make. So what we will assume is this model, and what it will allow us So is this model sort of clear to everyone, right? So there's just some big tape, right? So this, for instance, allows you to do the following, which you can't do here, like have a hash function, right? So suppose I want, for whatever reason in my algorithm, some function, let's say, which goes from some capital N to some capital M. Like if you give it a h of x, it will give you some random number in this range, right? Then, I mean, it could be that during my execution, I need to, every time I feed x, I need to output the same consistent h of x, right? So here I can do that, right? Because I can sort of take each block and map, think of it as a hash function. But sort of here I cannot do this because I can't remember the old values I saw, like if I need to compute.
So are you just thinking the random oracle model?
So by random oracle, you mean the first one?
Well, a random oracle is an oracle which is consistent on the same input.
Okay, yes. So we need a consistent,
yeah. That's a completely standard model.
Yes, okay, exactly, right. So, right. Yeah, so this is, So I guess different people call these things differently. So this is read-only, and if you're calling this random oracle, then that's fine. Good. All right, so I won't sort of elaborate on this again and again, but yeah, it's useful to note that this is what we assume. Okay. Now, somebody asked also about other applications. So again, the subset sum problem is quite robust. So let me mention one related problem called the knapsack problem. And sort of all these variants that you were asking kind of can be lie somewhere in between. So in the knapsack problem, you are given two weight functions. So there are sort of n items with weights w1 through wn, and there is a target which we think of sort of as a capacity b on the knapsack. So I shouldn't maybe call it a target. So t is just the capacity of this knapsack. And you are given values also, or rewards or profit, right? And your goal in the knapsack problem is to pick a subset of items so that they fit in the knapsack, so the weight of that item is no more than t, and you want to maximize the total value you gain, okay? Now, so here is a very surprising result. I forget the authors. So I think it's from 2010. At least one of the authors is Nederlof and a couple more people. So suppose I only gave you a subset sum oracle, right, which is just capable of answering that given a particular target T, is there some subset that sums up to that? So they showed that such an oracle, you can use only a polynomial number of times to actually solve this knapsack problem, which is surprising because suppose, I didn't even have any reward or whatever. Like I just wanted to, so the point is T is huge, right? So a priori you would think, okay, for every value of T, I need to solve this subset oracle again and again, right? But somehow, and if I get a chance time later on, I'll sort of try to describe this reduction. It's a very cute reduction. So somehow this seems much harder because there is no fixed value of T, there's all exponential range, but you can still
do it. I don't understand. If you give the subset sum as a black box, I can get the subset with the maximum reward.
Okay, so let me, so this is a bit messy. So let me say another problem. Let's say subset sum with a target interval. So there I had a fixed value T that you need to reach. Suppose here, and actually this matches exactly with your problem. So suppose I only had these n numbers w1 through wn, and I gave you a target interval, lower bound and an upper bound, and you want to see, is there some t here? So like you just want to find a subset that sums up to any value in this range, right? Now, a priori, this range could be exponential, right? These ln u can be, right? So like this could be, say, between 2 to the n and n, something like that. But you can still reduce this. So one way you can solve this is just for try every value of t and check subset sum, but this is very, very wasteful. But you can just do it in poly n time. When I first heard of this, I found it very surprising that you can. And you can't really do a binary search or anything, right? Okay, so first you might think, okay, you can do some binary search. But notice the subset oracle is not telling me, for binary search, I need like whether the target is in this half or that half. So this is a much weaker oracle. It's just telling you for that particular value of t, whether you can achieve it or not. So it's not clear how to do.
What about p-tasses?
Good. So p-tasses and all are not so hard. Like one way you can get it. So by p-tasses, I assume you mean just 1 plus minus epsilon t or something. So you can always hash these down numbers to a small range, like poly 1 over epsilon or 1 over poly. Right. So yeah, so that's a different, easier game. Good. So any other questions? OK. Good. All right, so let's see if I'm not forgetting anything I wanted to say. All right. So our the result that we'll give, this like has several applications. So one is you can immediately use this reduction and get a result for knapsack. Again, if I have time, I'll sort of elaborate on this, or maybe offline. And there are also various other applications to the K-sum problem, for those of you who know, and so on. But sort of, I'll not elaborate on those here. I'll just focus on this result, right? OK. So to show this result, our algorithm will have two ingredients. One is what's called Floyd's cycle finding. And again, this is one algorithm that's not very common in algorithms, but like crypto people use this all the time, or especially as a heuristic. And this is also called Pollard's row heuristic, which often people use as a, yeah, we'll see it's a very powerful thing. And
the Shamir is
Adi Shamir, yeah. Okay, so there is a, one of the first papers was using hardness of subset sum. There was a cryptographic protocol, I think, by Hellman and Merkel.
And it's quite exact.
Yeah, probably. So they assume, right. So subset sum is hard in some regime, maybe exact.
Yeah, it was one of the first public key.
Good.
So, anyway. It was broken pretty quickly.
Exactly. Using lattice. So yeah, crypto experts can probably answer that much better. Right. So subset sum is like, I think, all the time, knapsack subset sum studied in the crypto community. Oh, and maybe I should also elaborate. So yeah, so these are sort of in the worst case setting. So if your input is like a random input, so these WIs are chosen randomly from some range, and say target is also random, then people, yeah, so some results are maybe rigorous, some are heuristic. So people can sort of beat this. So I think the state of the art is roughly to the point. OK, there are some other decimals here. So beating like 2 to the n over 2 time in this random average case model. And they need some exponential space. Right, so, but though in the worst case, I said this is still an open problem to beat this 2 to the n over 2 time. So in random case, yeah, people can do a bit better. But that's sort of a whole different story. You exploit all kinds of properties. OK, good. So the first ingredient will be cycle finding. And I'll kind of explain this in a lot of detail later on. And the second will be some additive combinatorics properties of subset sum, again, which will become clear what we mean by this soon. OK, so let me focus on the first ingredient, cycle finding. OK, so what's the setting here? So suppose you have some function. And again, by the square brackets, you do the usual thing. I mean 1 through n. Right? So suppose I have a function which takes any number in this range, I, and sort of maps it to f of I. Right? So suppose we are interested in finding, so let's call a, OK. So let's see how this can be viewed as a graph. Right? So I think of a graph on n vertices, 1 through n. Now for every, say, I can put an arc which goes to f of I, right? So this f kind of defines a graph. It's a directed graph without degree 1, right? So how can this look like? So maybe you start from here. You apply f, you go there. You come back. It could be like this. Or maybe it could do crazy things. You can have a cycle. The picture. You can also get more crazy things. things like this and so on. Right? Okay. So what does cycle finding mean? Now, one thing is, you know, no matter which point I start with, let's say I start at some I, if I keep applying F again and again and again, you know, I can't go on infinitely, it's a finite graph, so at some point I'll repeat it, I'll find a cycle. Right? And the goal in cycle finding is to indeed find such a cycle, so given some starting point, right? So there was a very nice algorithm by Floyd, which does the following. So it just keeps two pointers, so order one space, or depends how you count, so you can also call it order log n space, depending on whether you're counting bits or sort of things. So you store two pointers, and the goal is to find sort of a cycle. And actually, we'll be particularly interested in what's called this point, because if you look at this point, there are sort of two indices I and j, so that fi is equal to fj, right? So this is kind of a colliding pair. So I and j is a colliding pair if this happens. And and this algorithm, Floyd's algorithm is, so let me describe what Floyd's algorithm is. And it's also called the tortoise and hare algorithm. Okay, so what it'll do is, you give it a starting point. It will sort of keep going. At some point, we know that this will hit back to something you have seen. And our job is to sort of detect this vertex. Right? And this kind of thing is most useful. So think of it as this f is kind of an implicit function, right? Like, so if you give me a particular point, I can evaluate it, but I don't know anything else about this. And that's why sort of it's useful in. Yes, yes. So, or just some, circuit or oracle which just feed in an input, it tells you the next arc. But I can't do sort of anything deep with this, right? So that's where this kind of thing is most useful in. And, okay, so how does this algorithm work? So so you're given the starting position, it keeps two pointers. So actually, how many of you have seen this? Maybe, okay. Yeah, it's very good because, I kind of heard of this Pollard flow, but I never quite realized how cute it is. So let me maybe spend a couple of minutes explaining this. So you maintain two pointers, right? So think of one as a hare and one as a tortoise, I guess a slower one. So this tortoise moves at sort of speed one, and the hare moves twice, at twice the speed, right? So you start walking. Yeah, so both of them sort of start from here and keep going. And you keep doing this until at some point, the hare and the tortoise are in the same position, right? And notice this will happen because if there is a cycle, at some point, they will catch up, right? Like, okay. So suppose it happens at some point here, then you can do sort of, okay, so you remember that point, oh, this happened. And now you do the, so these will be small exercises. So at first time you detect a collision, so notice you're only storing two things in your mind, right? You just sort of, these pointers. The first time there is a collision, now bring sort of the hare back here and keep the tortoise here. And now let both of them move at speed one. And you can show that you'll always meet at this point. And then it's a cute trick. So one way you can prove this is, suppose this sort of stem was of length A and this was of length B. You can kind of precisely compute at which point they will hit together just by writing a linear equation. And then, almost by magic, there's no reason why this should be true, but the solution will have the form that this distance is exactly equal to this distance. So, or like plus some multiple of that, and they will merge, right? So again, there's no reason why this should have been the case, but it is the case, so it works, right? Good. So the point is, just by using these sort of two pointers, you can figure out this. And once you have this point, you can do all kinds of things, right? You can go back, sort of see, like ultimately because you're interested in this colliding pair, let's call it I star and J star. But once you have a handle on this, you can go back, figure all kinds of things, again in sort of linear time. Okay, good. So, and again, there are various variants. So let's see why this is cool, because so far it just seems some elementary puzzle. So here is a very nice paper of Beame et al. Paul Beame from, I think, Fox 13 a couple of years ago, which gave a application of this to what's called the element distinctness problem. So what's this problem? So you're given a list of n numbers. Okay. And your job is to figure out whether two numbers are the same or not. So do there exist some I and j so that xi equal to xj, right? For some I not equal to j. Or is everything distinct, or there is sort of two numbers which are the same? Good. Now, again, if you had, say, linear space, one way you could solve this is just sort the list, right? And now it's easy to check, you know, just see two consecutive things are the same or not. So with n space, sort of you can do it in O tilde n time or n log n time to be precise. But now suppose I only gave you like constant space or log n bits or whatever, however you want to think of it. How well can you do, right? So let's see. So I can't do anything like sorting. You know, I can just sort of roughly probe two positions or some constant number of positions and I do to figure out a duplicate. So let's actually do like a test. So suppose there were like, so this is kind of the hardest example. Suppose just two values were the same and rest were all different, right? So the answer to this where you want to distinguish versus, yeah, whether you have the two identical values or not. So if you just did random sampling, like I just probe two values, check whether they're the same. So how many queries will I need roughly? Right, so about n square, right? Because, right, like I have to get these two exactly right to do this. And yeah, it's not actually, and in fact, before this paper, I think it was not clear what you could do. So what they did was they gave a, so they also have a lower bound in some branching program model. I mean, you have to restrict your model, otherwise, you know, we don't know how to prove any lower bounds. Right, so they can give it, but in a, yeah, pretty strong. So they gave an upper bound, which gets n to the 3/2 time, and again, sort of using only order one space, and using cycle finding, okay? So let's see what's, so let me describe this algorithm to you, because I'll kind of build up on these things.
The interesting puzzle is, if I tell you the opposite, like every element is repeated except one, then you can do an integer,
and this is like a classic
puzzle. So
I
was thinking, so you keep doing XOR, so the same elements keep
canceling.
I see. Okay,
right. I see.
Yeah.
Good.
Right. Yeah.
But this was, yeah.
Okay, so I was thinking,
yeah, this
why.
Goes, right.
Good. Right. So is the problem clear?
Yeah.
Good. So the algorithm is the following, what they do. And actually, before we do the algorithm, let's do sort of one other puzzle or whatever exercise. So suppose in this graph, the function f was a random function. So suppose f was a random function from n to n, right? Now, how will this function look like? So suppose I start at some, so I think of this as an n-vertex graph. I start at some point, let's say I, and I keep going. At what point will I hit my cycle? So what's the guess? So like, right, so suppose I have a random function, right? So each value I is completely mapped uniformly at random independently to some guy there. If I start at some I, yeah, so how will this sort of piece look like? Like I keep going until I hit back something I've already seen. How long do you expect this? Like n over 3? Okay, no. So let's say, okay, I'm going, I've seen t vertices so far. Now if I take the next hop, right, if I see something that I've already seen, I stop, right? So if I'm like t steps far away, what's the chance I already see something I've seen? Exactly, right? So yeah. Exactly, it's a Bezier paradox. Right. It's also exactly right? So exactly by the birthday paradox or just by this, like at each step it's t over n. So once t becomes like root t, after another root t steps, you're almost likely to hit. So good. So, right. And also, you know, you're taking a random hop, right? So once you've seen this root t, you'll somewhere land in the middle here, right? So you expect this stem to be around of root t, root n length, and the cycle also to be around root n length. Okay. So this will be sort of the underlying observation of this. So let's see how they do this. Okay, so let me make sure. Okay, so you define, good. So you're given this list with numbers x1 through xn. So define your function f of I. So again, I will be, so f will be from n indices to n indices. These numbers can be arbitrary. So I will pick a random hash function h, you can see. All right, so let's say these xi's are in the range, you know, 1 through m, where m is some big number, could be whatever. So I have this hash function which takes, say, some xi and maps it to something between 1 and n. Right? So I'll define my function f of I, where I is between 1 and n, to be h of xi. So in other words, I want to compute my function, let's say, on the ith position. I look at what's the entry xi there, compute the hash value of that number, spits me something back, and that's the function, okay? Good. Now, if this h is a completely, say, uniform hash function, you will kind of, it's exactly this picture. Except, okay, so if all these entries were distinct, then it will be exactly like a random map. But if, say, two entries are the same, x and x, right, then, so let's say, some xi was same as xj equal to x, so here and here. Then, right, then f of I is equal to f of j, right? So we'll get a collision. Okay, so the idea of this algorithm, right. So in particular, if whenever two values are the same, or like values in two indices I and j, are the same xi and xj. In this view, you will, no matter what your hash function is, you'll always get a collision, right? So the algorithm will work like this. So, yeah, so you're, say, given some graph implicitly defined by your f. You just find all the points where collisions happen, okay? Now in general, there could be also some fake points where collisions happen, right? Because, you know, like, say there was some x and y, need not be the same, but your function h was sort of a random. So it could be that your h of x was equal to h of y for due to the randomness in your function. So you could still get a collision, right? Because if you evaluate, say if this was at I and I prime position, these f would map to the same thing. So one thing is, let's look at that particular example where, and this is sort of the hardest case, where only there was one pair which is duplicate. So how many fake collisions will be there? Or let's say all the values were distinct in this table, all the n values. How many fake collisions will you get when, how many? Okay, what else?
M by n.
So just think of it as a random graph on n vertices, right? Because if, because this m doesn't, this h really hashes it down. So if I look at a particular vertex, right? So we know a vertex only has out degree one, exactly. What's roughly the in degree? It's like a Poisson with mean one, right? It's like balls in bins. So I expect, right. So you would expect about order n collisions, right? Because with some exponentially decaying probabilities, like two collisions, three collisions at a vertex and so on. And what is it? So everybody's with me?
Yeah.
Right? So it's exactly, in fact, the balls and bins, right? N, you're throwing N balls in N bins. We are asking sort of...
How many bins have more than one?
Yeah, or actually more precisely, if this has like L balls in it, I'm counting like L square because maybe L minus 1 square, right? Or L into L minus 1. So that's the number of collisions. Or by two, whatever, right? So, but yeah, it'll be order N, roughly. Right, because this is like okay. 1 or 2. Good. So how does, so the point is, if you were in this thing, you have one real collision and roughly N fake collisions, right? So if you do this kind of cycle finding, yeah? So how does their algorithm work? You just pick some random vertex I, yeah? And just run this cycle, hare and tortoise algorithm until you find a collision, right? And then you check whether this is like a real colliding pair or a fake colliding pair, right? By just sort of probing xi star and xj star, are they sort of different or same? If they're same, you're done. It's not distinct. Otherwise, you realize, oh, it's fake pair, repeat it again. And the point is, for each cycle finding, you spend roughly about root n time, because this is a root n length cycle. It's a random graph. And in about, there are only like n fake things and one real thing. So after n tries, you expect to find your real thing. So it's n to the 3/2.
N log n.
Yeah, so, modulo log n.
So this is a randomized algorithm, right? It doesn't guarantee success.
Yes. So it will guarantee, yes, with constant probability you...
But you might have a false negative.
So false negative.
No, if you tried it could miss n times and you didn't find a real collision, there might still be a real collision.
Yes. But if there is a real collision with like half probability, you'll find it. You can do the usual thing, repeat it. Yes, so it's a randomized Monte Carlo, one-sided, whatever.
Yeah.
Exactly. Good. But it's sort of interesting that, yeah, so this buys you this n to the 3/2 versus the, so you're doing something much smarter than random sampling. Right, even though it looks like you're doing random sampling. Like somehow cycle finding is pointing you towards the right areas with, and it's not focusing on the bad areas.
With only 10 times.
Yeah. So that's where you gained something. Yeah. And it zoomed to you on the collision. Here you would like have to do several times to zoom in on the collision. So it's actually interesting to, yeah.
So you start with different vertices.
Yes.
Could you get the same performance if you just hash to square root n bytes and then do brute force in every byte, like square root n bytes times n for each byte?
Maybe, I don't know. Yeah, one has to see the computation. But, I mean, yeah, I don't know. But you're not gaining anything, right?
Yeah.
So. Maybe, yeah. Probably, I'm not sure. Okay. And also, yeah, one can give a simple argument to, you know, we only looked at this case, but in general, like, there are more pairs, it only sort of gets easier. I'll skip all that. Okay. So, right. Good. So let's see what we do. So we will use this sort of similar idea to solve what you call the list disjointness problems. Disjointness. So here you are given, let's say, two lists of length n each, right, and some y. Yeah, and each xi, yi, let's say, lies in some 1 through m. Now our task is to figure out whether there are two guys, you know, some xi and yj, which are the same. So it seems very similar to the previous problem, but it's a bit different because, you know, if I have two guys which are same here, I don't care. I really want from different lists two colliding guys. Okay. Now what one can show, and this is a theorem, so let me write it. Can find, let me call this a colliding pair, or a real colliding pair. Like with constant probability, some time n square root p. Now, what is this p parameter? So, the p parameter would be, so let me define this. So, it's p of x plus p of y. And this quantity is okay, so this is just a fancy way of saying, right? So I look at my list of n numbers, right? So maybe some quantity like L appears three times. So I look at the various frequencies of each element, each value V that's appearing. So X inverse V just means like how many times in this list value V appears. I look at the squared. So it's the sum of all the frequencies of the elements that are appearing, right? So if like one element, it was all the same element, it would be like n square. If everything was distinct, it will be n, so on, right? Okay, so I look at, so I'm given.
Does it become harder with larger p? Should it be easier?
Good, so somehow what's happening is, so we'll see the algorithm in a sec and it'll make sense, but somehow if you know, you have a lot of guys which appear, you know, this guy has a lot of duplicates in it or triplicates, whatever. This also, so these sort of fake duplicates will confuse you because you really want to find if there's something here and something here that's the same, but you don't care about these guys. So these guys mess you up, right? And how does, and in a, yeah, so let's just see how the algorithm works. So we do exactly, right, so in the distinct element distinctness problem that we talked about, if you just had one list and you wanted to find like the same entry. So there we just defined your f of I as h of x I, right? H was this hash function. Now here you do the following. You have two different lists, right? So we'll kind of take the same graph. So you construct the graph for h in the same way. Construct a graph for the list y in the same way. And now you sort of just randomly merge them. So what do I mean by this? So I have some vertex I. Let's say according to this graph, I would go to some position f of I. And according to my y, so I have this other function g of I, which is again h of, say, y of I. Right? If you like did the same thing with the values y here. So that would tell me to go somewhere else. So at each vertex I sort of toss another random coin, and I either pick just f of I or g of I. So I still have an out degree one graph. But the edge is now either f or g, like randomly chosen. And so I've kind of merged these things. Yes, and you do consistently, exactly. And the point is indeed that if I had like some different indices I and j, so that x of I, so what I'm hoping for, right? If xi was equal to yj in these two lists, then somehow I'll get lucky, and this will kind of map to h of xi, and this will map to h of yj. But xi and yj are the same value, so it'll map to the same thing. So we'll get a collision, because at each, but here you kind of use the map g for the y list, and here you use the map, and this will happen with a quarter probability or something, right? So again, sort of, yeah, doing the same obvious thing. And now you see why you could get confused, because by these fake things, because you're just finding collisions in this graph. So you could get lots of collisions, right, like f of x I in this way, right?
Okay.
And also notice that this parameter p, the sum of squared collisions, so this will lie in general between sort of n to constant factors and n square, right? N if all the entries were distinct, or 2n maybe. And if everything was, so yeah, you're always sort of better than n square, the naive thing, but right. So for this to do non-trivially better, you want your p to be sort of bounded away from n square, right? Okay, so how do we apply this to subset sum? Good. So we'll do this kind of, so if you remember this meet in the middle thing where we, let's clean up this picture. So we broke into n over 2 and n over 2. Right? We computed all possible 2 to the n over 2 sums here. Right? And for every a, I checked if there was a corresponding t minus a or not. So one thing is, by sort of shifting this, I can just think of this as a list disjointness problem, right? So I'm checking like for every sort of value a here, if there is a here also, right? I mean, I can subtract t, take the negative. So it's really like finding the two duplicate elements in these two lists, okay? And what the above, so here now, our length of the list is like 2 to the n over 2, right? So, and we saw we get a running time of like n root p, where p is the squared sum of frequencies here and the squared sum of frequencies here. So if the elements here were sort of mostly not duplicating too much, I have gained a huge improvement, right? Because, so I expect, like, I'll get roughly like n to the 3 halves, which will give me 2 to the 3 n over 4. This is really an ideal case. But of course, things here, nothing tells me that, you know, these lists should mostly have disjoint entries. It could be like, for all you know, everything here is essentially the same, and here is some other same value. Like, you could get a lot of these fake colliding pairs, in which case you are not going to gain anything. So the second idea is to show this structural result, which roughly says the following. So informal, then I'll give you the formal statement, and then maybe we'll stop in 5 minutes. So roughly this is saying the following, that, you know, suppose I have these numbers w1 through wn on which I'm doing the subset sum. So let's do the following. So if I make two left and right parts of n over 2 each randomly, right, and the random will be important. So I split them randomly now. Now, if it happens that, okay, now you look at all the 2 to the n over 2 sums here and 2 to the n over 2 sums here. If it happens that this p parameter for these lists is large, right? So lots of things are, entries are repeating in this sum. Then actually, the support, so what do I mean by this? So if I look at all, right. So look at all possible 2 to the n sums that you can form with this. Yeah, so the claim will be that this is small. So if p is large, and by large think of it, you know, something, will be some quantitative parameters. So maybe more precisely. So if p is bigger than this, right, because, so p lies between n square and n, right, and n is 2 to the n over 2. So it's sort of reasonably big, then this support is less than 2 to the 0.86 n. And this is a bit not, okay, so is the statement clear what we had? Okay. So you have these n numbers, right? So look at all the possible 2 to the n subsets of these and all possible sums that you get, right? So think of this as like a frequency vector. Like you get a sum 1, sum 2, all the 2 to the n sums. So lots of them will be the, you know. So I look at how many distinct sums you get in this picture. I'm denoting that by this. And the claim is the following, that if you did the following, like you broke this list randomly, and you looked at now within each piece all the 2 to the n over 2 sums here, 2 to the n over 2 sums there, then if you're getting lots of duplicates here, lots of duplicates there, then in this thing you will have mostly very few distinct sums. Okay, here is another way to think about it. So let's forget about this random split. So just look at these numbers w1 through wn. Look at all the possible 2 to the n different sums, right? So maybe sum 1 appears a lot of times. The second sum appears only once. Third sum only appears once. So I sort of plot this frequency vector, how often each sum is appearing. So this is morally saying that if, you know, even one So the picture sort of cannot look. So a priori, it could be that out of these 2 to the n sums, maybe these, like, half of them appear only once each, and the remaining half of these subsets sum up to the same. So this frequency is like 2 to the n minus 1. So it's saying this cannot happen. Like, if this is, if any sort of bucket is too large, then actually your support will be small. Okay? And this is, I mean, there is, again, no a priori reason, you know, why can't you have this? Right? So it's a, yeah, it's a non-trivial property. And indeed, we need methods from additive combinatorics to show this. So let me just, let me just state this independent combinatorial statement which underlies this, and then I'll not say, I mean, it's...
So then eventually your algorithm is like...
Oh, good. Good. So if my p parameter is small, right, then sort of I just do list cycle finding and I gain. Yeah, so in particular, if p is smaller than this, I gain. And if you compute this, yeah, this will be 2 to the 0.86n. But if p is bigger than this, and again, I have no way of finding, so I'll run sort of both and see which works. But if p is bigger, I have this structural property that, these guys are sort of, there is a lot of degeneracy or whatever. You can't have too many distinct sums. And then if your instance satisfies that property, you can do another trick. So, right, like you can just hash. Right, so if your instance was not generating too many distinct sums, like only 2 to the 0.86n, one way you can do this is just pick a random prime which is around this value. Just consider everything modulo p. So you kind of hash numbers into that range and use a dynamic programming algorithm. Right? And actually here we are now using the faster version of dynamic programming. And again, the point is you have not too many distinct sums, right? So even if you hash, you will not get fake collisions too much. Just hash like 10 times the range or whatever. So your original target t still with constant probability, nothing else. So again, that's sort of standard tricks. Yeah, if you're, yeah, this was. Okay. And good. So let me just write that one small key lemma and then we'll stop. So here is a right. So suppose you have some subset A of 0, 1 vectors of length n, and another subset B of vectors of length n, which contains entries in minus 1, 0, 1. Then, and suppose you have the property that if I pick any A in A and B in B, right, any two vectors, and I look at the sum in sort of z to the n, right? So if I took any two vectors and then their coordinate will lie between either these values, right? Because any coordinate of A is either 0, 1, any coordinate of B is either 0, 1. So I look at all such A and B. So if A and B, if A plus B sort of uniquely determines A comma B, or in other words, if your sets here have this property that so A plus B is sort of all pairs of the type A plus B, the Minkowski sum. So it's exactly cardinality of A times A of B. So it's sort of a uniquely determined pair. Then, and also say the support of every vector B in B is D. So it only has like D minus ones and ones. Then one of the points is that this cardinality of this set cannot be too big. So you can get sort of very tight bounds on. So it's like one of these cap set sum problems, or typically what you see in additive combinatorics, right? Like if you're sort of generating, you have some strong additive property, then these things in general cannot be too much big. Otherwise, you'll get various collisions. And somehow, yeah, so it's maybe another like couple of lemmas to go from this to subset sum, and you can get this. So you sort of have this win-win algorithm in the back. So if there are a lot of fake collisions, then your support is small and you do a standard algorithm. There are few fake collisions, you do cycle finding. So yeah, so let me maybe stop there and then. Yeah, so that's sort of right. So this is coming because like if you look at the gap from 2.10, it's like 0.14. So it's sort of when everything balances out, right? This n root p bound and the hashing bound. And the 0.72 comes from, you know, you get certain things from here, you optimize the constants. But yeah, at the heart is this sort of structural property of, so we call this sort of smoothness of sums, like your frequency vectors cannot be sort of crazily like they have. If one is large, then sort of everybody is large, morally. Good, so let me stop here.
So what do you think is the barrier?
For breaking? So this also, okay, so I think the biggest question here is, this thing. I think a lot of people have tried this. And for lots of very, very, I mean, yeah. So in many special cases, yeah, people can break this, you know, making various assumptions. So random instance is one and so on. But yeah, like, I don't know, yeah. So, and, you know, first time when I heard about this also, I had the similar thoughts, right? Can't you do the Shamir's trick recursively, whatever? Who knows, maybe somebody will find something, I don't know. So it's not clear what's an obvious barrier, but.